Hi everybody, in this video, we are going to learn how to deploy an AWS Lambda function using Serverless Framework. Now, there are going to be some assumptions before we just get started. The assumptions for this video are, you already know the concept of serverless and how theoretically a serverless environment should work, at least roughly. You should also know what AWS Lambda is. And in that sense, you already know how AWS Lambda works in a serverless environment. Basically, you know that Lambda hosts your code, and then with the help of API Gateway, you can associate a web API to your Lambda function. You should also already have Node.js installed on your machine. So you can go to this URL, nodejs.org, and follow the download instructions in order to download Node.js onto your computer. Or you can use your preferred packet manager. For example, right now I'm using a Windows machine and I like Chocolaty as my packet manager, so I use that to download Node.js. Finally, the most important assumption is you have an AWS account. Can't deploy our AWS Lambda function without already having an AWS account. So now that we've already covered those assumptions, let's talk about Serverless Framework. Serverless Framework is a CLI that helps you develop and deploy your AWS Lambda functions, along with the AWS infrastructure that is required. Serverless Framework provides you with IAC, that's infrastructure as code. Basically, this is a way of creating, deploying, and maintaining your services or resources on the cloud with machine-readable configuration files. Serverless Framework is a wrapper on top of AWS CloudFormation. And unlike AWS CloudFormation, the configuration files that we can write are small and manageable, and then the code in Serverless Framework handles the rest of the complex changes behind the scene. Now that we've covered these basics, let's get started. So you should have already installed Node on your machine. So right here, if I write Node V, you can see back, that's my version of Node. You can have a lower version of Node, that's fine. At the time of this video, the LTS version for Node is 16.17.0. All right, so you have Node installed. Let's install the serverless framework. So we will write npm install. -g means that we are installing the serverless framework globally. You can check to make sure serverless framework is installed properly by writing serverless-v. We'll show back the version that has been installed. So we have the framework core is 3.22, our plugin 6.2.2, and our SDK is 4.3.2. Okay, so we have serverless framework installed. Now we need to make sure that our AWS credentials are configured to our computer. Now, this is important not only for serverless framework, but also for just interacting with other AWS services. So if you haven't done this already, you should go ahead and do it. I'm going to show you how to set it up using a Windows machine, but you can read the installation instructions for AWS to set up your AWS credentials. So there are directions for Linux, Mac, and Windows. So for a Windows environment, you either download and run the MSI, or you can use the MSI exec command to install the AWS CLI. I am now going to go through the default settings of this setup wizard, and after we are done installing the AWS CLI, we will then learn how to set up our AWS credentials. Now that we've installed the AWS CLI, let's just confirm that the installation worked. So let's write AWS --version. and you see this is the AWS CLI's version, and then also Python and everything else that we have on our machine. If you are on a Windows machine, you may not be able to just immediately do your AWS version here. You might have to exit out of your command line and then go back in. So now that we've installed the AWS CLI, we need to configure the CLI to use our AWS credentials. So the fastest way to do this is to type in AWS configure. Now you're prompted with an AWS access key ID. Well, in order to populate this, we need to get an access key ID from our AWS account. So it's time to log in to our AWS console. So now I've logged into my AWS console as my root user. Actually, for this account, I only have my root user. And that is the problem. For best practices, you should only use your root user account for a few account and service management tasks. Other than that, you should lock that root user away and have different users that can perform administrative functions. So in order to do this, we go to our IAM console and we create an administrative user. So what we want to do now is create a new user that would be an administrator and it would be part of an admin user group. So in the IAM console, we are going to go to our users and we are going to click add user and let create an admin user. So for the username in this scenario, I'm going to call them administrator. And this will be enabled via a password so that this user can sign into the AWS console as well. And so that I know the user's password, because I'm going to use this administrative account, I'm going to choose a custom password and add in the password I know. Now, by default, you can require a password reset, where when the user logs in, they have to create a new password on the next sign-in. This is going to be me, so I actually don't want this. But if you were going to be providing this to someone else, you shouldn't really know the password afterwards. So you unchecked it for that security measures. Next, we need to add our permissions. We do not have any groups yet, so we have to create a group. Let's name this group administrators. And we are going to give them the administrator access level. As you can see here, there are many types of policies that you can provide. So you can either give full access, partial access. When you create a user and you put them in specific groups, make sure to limit it. You don't want everybody to be admins. Maybe there's going to be groups that only need to access Elastic Beanstalk. Narrow it down. That is the best security practice, is to limit access and grant access when necessary. Don't just give access to everybody. In this case, we are making an administrator, so we're going to give them the administrative access, which gives full access to the AWS services and resources. Now, the next area is a tag. A IAM tag is a key value pair that you can use to add to your user, and they can use different information, like you can have your email address or certain descriptions or the job title, as they mentioned here. This is optional. You do not have to add any, but this is useful when you want to track or control access for the specific user. Finally, we're going to review the user we created. The username's administrator. They have access to the AWS management console with a password. The password type is console. And in this case, no password reset is required. So let's create this user. So now we have successfully created our administrator user. And this user can log in. So you will have your AWS account ID, and then you can go to the URL that is going to be displayed here in this black box. And you could sign in as this user. So we have created a user. Now, with this user, we want to create an access key. So we're back to the user screen, and now we're going to go into our user. And on the security credential side, we are going to create an access key. as it says here, is used to make programmatic calls to the AWS CLI and other tools. And the user can have a maximum of 2 access keys that are active or inactive at a time. If you lose or if you forget your access key, you can't view it again. So instead, you need to create a new access key and make the old key inactive. I think you should already know this, but you should never share your secret keys with anyone. And you should rotate your keys pretty frequently. So we're going to create our access key. So here, you should see your access key ID and your secret access key. If you click close without copying this or downloading the CSV file, it is gone. You will have to make it inactive and generate a new access key. So right now, as it says right here, this is the only time the secret access key can be viewed or downloaded. You can't recover it. So download it now. Download the CSV file. So now that you've downloaded the file, you know where it's located, you can click close, and we can take that access key ID and secret that we have retrieved and populate it in the AWS CLI prompt that we have in our command line. So going back to our AWS configure, we can add our AWS access key. So you can copy it from your CSV that you downloaded. You are then prompt with your secret access key, which again, you can copy from the CSV you've downloaded. And now you want to choose your default region name. So in my case, I'm going to choose US East 1. And for the default output format, I am going to do JSON. So now that we have this all set up, we can make a simple Lambda function and deploy it using Serverless Framework. So what I'm going to do here is a small demo of an AWS Lambda function that will be deployed using the Serverless Framework. Let's start with using the templates that are provided by Serverless. So we can type serverless in our terminal, and we are prompted with a choice of what do we want to make. You can use the up and down arrows to select what you want. I am going to choose the Node.js starter example. Now, after choosing what type of project I want to make, it asks me, what do I want to call this project? I'm going to call this serverless demo example. And now it is downloading the serverless demo example and it's adding it to the folder. I already have the file structure opened in Visual Studio Code, so the folder is now there. Now, the next question that is being prompted here is if I want to log in or register this with the serverless dashboard. It is not required to have a serverless account. You can have a serverless account if you want. In this example, not going to have one. So I'm going to choose no. And now it asks me if I want to deploy now. If I choose yes, it will deploy to my AWS account. Right now, I am going to choose no because I do not want it to deploy right now. So when we are ready to deploy, we will run the command serverless deploy, but we're not there yet. We need to walk through the template that was provided to us. So first, let's look at the handler.js. It's just a simple message that says go serverless 3.0 and telling you that your function executed successfully. For this demo, we are not going to change this. Also has a README file that is auto-generated, and it breaks down how you could deploy this template and where to find more examples. Finally, there is the YAML file. It contains the information regarding our AWS resources. So talks about our provider name, the runtime environment that we're doing, and then the function's name. In this case, the function is hello, and the handler is handler.hello. That goes back to our handler, and we know that it is hello. So keep in mind that every Lambda function you create as part of this project has to be registered here in functions in order for it to deploy successfully. So let's test this function locally. So what I'm going to write here in a new terminal is serverless invoke local function, and the function name is hello. And we get back our result that was defined in our handler here. That status code 200 with the message being go serverless 3.0. There are more commands that you can do when calling the serverless invoke. For example, if you don't include local, you're actually going to invoke the call on your AWS instance after you've deployed it. So if we do serverless invoke and do not include local function, hello, it's actually going to error because it is looking in our default AWS regions, all those setups that we did in the AWS CLI, where we put in our key and our secret. It's using our key and secret to access our AWS account. It looks into our default region, which is US East 1, and it looks for this function, but it is not there because it has not been deployed. You can specify the region. So if you include dash dash region, then if you were going to deploy it to a different region, you can then invoke from that region. You can also specify another AWS profile because you can have more than one AWS profile. We have just one and that's our default. So let's deploy this code now. So we can type serverless deploy, and it's going to use the default settings that we had set up with our AWS CLI. So you can see here, it's saying that it's deploying our serverless demo example to stage dev. It's creating the cloud formation stack necessary. So after it goes through deploying the serverless demo example and sets up the cloud formation stack, the service will be deployed to the stack. In this case, serverless demo example dev. So let's check it out in our AWS console. So first we can find our demo example in CloudFormation. So go to CloudFormation. You can see there is our stack name that we just completed, serverless demo example dev. This has been just created. If you go to your Lambda console, you'll see the functions that you created. Here is our function, serverless demo example hello. If there was more would have been added as well. If we go into the console, we can see the code. And this is the code that we had before that was deployed here successfully. And we can even test it here if we want it to. So last but not least, let's go back and try to invoke it again from our terminal, not locally this time. Now here, call our invoked function hello. And there is our response. This is not being run locally. So congratulations, you have now learned how to deploy an AWS Lambda function using serverless framework. If you liked what you saw, please remember to subscribe to my channel so you can get notified of more AWS tutorials. And until then, happy learning.